Good evening, everyone. I'm Steve Edwards, the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's event entitled The New Conservative Agenda. It's a fitting conversation not only because of the change in power in the United States Senate and the Republican leadership in both houses of Congress that we'll expect after the first of the year, but also as candidates are vying for the Republican nomination in 2016, and I think perhaps more centrally, vying to define where the party and what conservatism means and where it goes in the years ahead. Tonight's conversation, as many of you know, is part of our ongoing speaker series, which aims to provide leading experts on key issues of the day in a forum that hopefully elevates and expands the public conversation. Tomorrow night, we will be back here on campus with a conversation that focuses on national security in the 21st century, featuring an outstanding panel that includes former U.S. Ambassador to NATO, Ivo Dalder, former Congresswoman Jane Harman, and as well, current Washington Post reporter David Ignatius, promises to be a great conversation. You can find out more about all of our events at politics.uchicago.edu. You can also subscribe to a podcast of all of our events by going to iTunes U and searching for UChicago IOP. Tonight during our conversation, as is customary, we will turn the microphone over to you, the members of our audience, a bit later so that you can pose your questions to our panelists. When we do, we ask that you keep your conversation, or your question rather, short and to the point so that we can get to as many of you as possible. We will also prioritize students in the overall mix of questioners tonight. It's now my great pleasure to turn things over to Max Samuels to introduce our distinguished panel for tonight's conversation. Max is a third year here at the University of Chicago. He is a former president of the College Republicans on campus. He currently leads the UChicago Political Union and is the UChicago chair of the American Enterprise Institute on campus chapter. Please join me in welcoming Max Samuels. Max?
Thank you, Steve. I can't do it without paper. Sorry, guys. It's my honor to introduce today's panel. Republicans won a sweeping electoral victory last November, yet many Americans struggle to identify with an affirmative party message. The IOP has assembled today's most sought-after conservative policy wonks to tell us how they think that the Republican Party can close this gap. These thought leaders collaborated to write Room to Grow, a manifesto for a reformicon agenda that makes conservatism work for the middle class. When commentators refer to the intellectual resurgence of the Republican Party, they are referring to our guest today, and I have no doubt you will soon see why. Our first panelist is Andrew Kelly, the director of the Center on Higher Education Reform at the American Enterprise Institute. He researches higher education policy, including financial aid reform. Dr. Kelly is a prolific author whose work has appeared in publications ranging from the American Journal of Education to The Atlantic. Yuval Levin is the Hertog Fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center and holds a variety of senior editorial positions, chief among them as editor of National Affairs. He served on the domestic policy staff of the Bush White House and earned his PhD at the University of Chicago. He recently published The Great Debate, Edmund Burke, Thomas Paine, and the Birth of Right and Left. April Ponnuru is a veteran Capitol Hill staffer and the policy director for the YG Network, which published the Room to Grow essays. She has served in both Senate and House leadership, including as senior advisor to Senator Roy Blunt of Missouri. Previously, she served as executive director of the nonprofit National Review Institute. Her husband, Ramesh Ponnuru, is a senior editor for National Review, a columnist for Bloomberg View, and a visiting fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. Ramesh is one of the most prolific and respected commentators in Washington, and his work can be found in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and many, many other places. Ramesh served as an IOP fellow in 2013, and we are thrilled to have him back. Last but certainly not least, our moderator this evening will be Megan McArdle, a Bloomberg View columnist who writes on economics, business, and public policy. Ms. McArdle is also behind the popular blog Asymmetric Information, and a UChicago Business School alum. She is currently completing her term as an IOP Fall Fellow. As you see, we have a ton of talent here today, so please join me in welcoming the participants.
So I'm going to start off by asking you a question, Ramesh. 2014 was a great year for Republicans, right? We had and maybe not a tsunami, but certainly like a decent sizable wave. I say we as a nation, not personally as a Republican. Why does conservatism need to be reformed? Why not just keep on keeping on?
Well, first of all, it's okay to say you're Republican if you are. You're my friends. I think that one thing that Republicans should have learned from recent years is that the midterm electorate looks very different from the presidential electorate. And you can be very good at winning midterm elections without having what it takes to win presidential elections. I think that's for a couple reasons. One is because it's easier to get people to let you apply the brake pedal than it is to get them to give you control over the steering wheel. And presidential elections, I think the public thinks of as much more steering wheel elections. And they need to know that Republicans want to take them somewhere they want to go before they'll do that.
Hence all the Obama metaphors about driving the
car
getting
into the ditch.
That's
right, yeah. And then the other thing is that there's always been a demographic distinction between who turns out in midterms and who turns out in presidential elections, where, for example, you have the midterm electorate is older and whiter, for example. In recent years, that demographic distinction has taken on a much more partisan cast than it used to. So we now, I think, have a structural feature of our politics where Republicans tend to outperform in midterms and Democrats in presidential elections. So you don't need to reform anything if you're a Republican who is fine with having a congressional majority. It's easy to keep the House majority, relatively speaking. It's a little harder, but still quite doable to take a Senate majority. You've got to reach a little further if you want to form a governing center-right majority in this country, which is what I would be interested in.
So, April, I'm going to go to you, since you are the YG Network fearless leader. What is reform conservatism? Is it a bunch of different ideas? Is it merely a sense that we need to reform conservatism and okay, let's do it?
Right.
Or is there some sort of coherent core here that's a kind of philosophy?
Right. I mean, I think we're very comfortable in the conservative tradition. I don't think we're, in that sense, offering anything new. That the principles that conservatism has espoused for a long time, certainly over the last few decades, are principles that we're comfortable with and feel need to be expanded upon. I think what reform conservatism is the effort to apply those principles to the problems that we face today. So, where conservatives or Republicans have often had an agenda that focuses on bringing down the marginal tax rate, right, which was, pre-Reagan confiscatory. I mean, we were talking about a 70% rate. And there was a real urgent need at the time to bring that rate down. Reagan saw that need, and he prioritized. He applied the conservative principles that we believe in to that situation, and said, "Look, we need to bring this rate down, dramatically." And he did, and he was effective, partly because we were successful. A lot of our agenda has become rather outdated. We haven't been responding to the challenges of our day. And so reform conservatism is really trying to bring to bear the principles that we believe in to the particular policy challenges that we face as a nation today.
So Yuval, could you talk a little bit about what are the core policy challenges that Republicans mm-hmm. aren't addressing now or aren't addressing effectively now
yeah.
and need to be?
Well, let me say, I agree entirely with what April says, and I think it's important that I'm not entirely sure where the term reform conservatism came from, though I don't dislike the term. I think of it as a reforming conservatism. In other words, our target is not conservatism. Our target is the government and the nation's challenges, and what's required to address those is a reform of our governing institutions and of a lot of public policy. And so it is applied conservatism, and what that means in practice, it seems to me, is a modernization of conservatism's understanding of the challenges the country faces. I don't think it's a change in how we as conservatives need to think about solving public problems. I think it's a change in what we understand those problems to be. And so if, as you say, in 1981, where a lot of conservatives like to live, the problems had to do with hyperinflation and with high marginal income tax rates, Today, the challenges have more to do with the consequences of globalization for working Americans. They have more to do with stagnating wages. They have more to do with the pressures that middle-class families confront. To the extent that we want to talk about tax reform, I think that the tax burden is especially heavy as a result of the payroll tax and not the income tax for most Americans. And it means thinking about how conservative ideas need to be applied to contemporary challenges. The most difficult thing for both parties now, I think, is to see the present, is to look beyond the to-do list that they've both had for such a long time and to actually think about what the country's to-do list ought to be. A lot of Democrats like to live in the mid-60s, a lot of Republicans like to live in the early 80s, because those are times when it seemed like they had something real to offer and the country saw it too. The country doesn't live there in either of those times, and you just can't pretend that they do. I think the fact that both parties are trying so hard to pretend is why so many Americans are frustrated with politics.
Yeah, I look at the list of things that Reagan got done, and some of them, you know, he lowered taxes. On the other hand, on regulation, not so much. And
yeah.
So I actually want to go to the end of our back there. Hi. And talk a little bit about Republican anti-intellectualism. This is a charge that gets labeled a lot, is that they're sort of, rather than having an education policy, rather than, they're just sort of reflexively anti the academy, and all of that represents, including coming up with policy. I mean, can you talk a little, is that true? Is it fair? Or?
I think it is. I mean, you know, when I think about the sort of traditional, the well-worn talking points on higher ed, right? The one of them is lefty faculty and permissive norms on campus, right? This started with Reagan as governor of California, right? This was his take on Berkeley. I mean, I think he described something, you know, orgies that are beyond description or something, right? It was the way he described what happened on campus at Berkeley. So,
which also served as a recruiting device.
Yes,
exactly. Right, precisely. So that's always been a part of this discussion, and rightfully so. I mean, you know, you're going to look on a college campus, and you're going to see these departments of under-enrolled majors, you know, ethnic studies and women's studies, and so on. And that's going to be something that to a mainstream conservative is going to be not something that they're interested in, or interested in subsidizing, for that matter. That's one of the traditional talking points on it. For me, that's a symptom of a much larger problem, right? And that is a market that doesn't function effectively, so that consumers can say, you know, I don't want to go learn from a professor that's going to fill, you know, my mind with all sorts of nonsense and things that are going to, you know, make my parents blush, right? But instead, your only choice these days, frankly, as an up and coming high school graduate, is to go off to a 4-year college and enroll in a place, if you want to get ahead, and enroll in a place that is populated, happens to be populated with that type of faculty. But again, that's a function of a market that rewards that kind of behavior. And that sort of product, because you know there's not a broader array of options open to people, and so I think we get bogged down in the politics, the sort of hand-to-hand combat, right, over liberalism on campuses, and we lose sight of the fact that that's a symptom of this broader problem.
So Yuval, is that preventing Republicans though from having the kind of resources that, yeah, as policy advisors, that Democrats can draw deep into the economy, and Republicans have a small handful of, yeah, of Republicans, conservatives at any given university?
I think the question of anti-intellectualism and the right is a very complicated and important question. It's not as simple as a lot of people make it out to be. In a certain sense, conservatives are much more intellectual in their thinking about politics than liberals. Liberals want to be understood as pragmatists. Conservatives want to think of themselves as having some kind of philosophy. At the same time, there's this attitude about the academy, and there's the actual academy, which justifies a lot of that attitude.
Yes, in
not
fairness,
all of it.
I don't think Reagan was wrong to say that the faculty at Berkeley was lefty.
Not always here at Chicago, but sometimes, and in a lot of other places. I do think that that has meant that, as you say, conservatives have not been able to draw on the academy in the same way. So I run a quarterly journal of essays about public policy. And a lot of the people who write for us are people who ought to be academics but aren't. Mm-hmm. They're people who are at think tanks when they'd rather be teaching. There are people who are on Wall Street when they'd rather be academics and intellectuals. And the reason is they think they can't be academics because they're conservatives. In some cases, they're right. I think that in a lot of cases, they're not right. But that's an attitude that's very prevalent on the right. And it's why conservatives tend to rely more on think tanks and liberals more on universities. I think there's a huge advantage in that for the left because universities just seem to offer more credibility than a think tank that's kind of understood to be a political actor. But it is a reality. I would also say my own attitude about the academy is different from a lot of conservatives. I think there's an enormous amount of very valuable work being done in the social sciences. There's not in today's academy, in the way there used to be, is the just amazing generalist, the extraordinary learned intellectual that even through the 1960s and into the 70s we saw in the American academy, and that played a big part, actually, in the development of conservatism in America. That person is really hard to find now. That person would have a very hard time getting and keeping an academic job. And that's a fault of the university, and has not been any better for the university than it's been for conservatives. But there are a lot of great specialists, and I don't think it's right to see the academy as a kind of sea of useless inanity. There's a lot of good work being done, and there's a lot of useless inanity, and that's just the nature of the thing.
Thankfully, unlike journalism, where it's
of 100%.
Of course, right. So I'm going to throw out a list of some issues that are kind of like the big issues that people are talking about right now: healthcare, immigration, inequality, family formation, climate change. Which of those does this address effectively, and which of them doesn't? You know, do we not yet have a?
Yeah. Well, I mean, one dimension of reform conservatism is an attempt to supply politically effective answers for conservatism about the issues that most Americans care about. And and in part, that involves reorienting the conversation to the issues most Americans care about. And that was an interesting list that you put out there. I mean, if you think about the conversation in Washington, D.C. over the last 2 years, how much of it has been about immigration or inequality or climate change, issues that on a good day will get a combined 6% of the American public saying that's the top issue that that Congress ought to be thinking of. And the issues that Americans really want to focus on are these bread and butter concerns about the cost of living, about wage stagnation. Healthcare is definitely one of them. But they don't, you know, they don't think about it in these issues in the ideological terms that the left and the right do. They like smaller government. It's not their top priority, getting smaller government. They don't like inequality. It's not at all a high priority for them. What they really want is a rising standard of living for people in the middle of the income spectrum. And that's what I think we're talking about. Now, I think, you know, I have my own views about each and every one of the issues that you discussed.
You're kidding. That's surprising.
But I think that it's very easy for political activists and actors to get caught up in the issues that animate us and lose sight of the issues that are of foremost concern of the people.
Well, April, let me ask, why does that happen? Why do we end up focused on these things? As I agree, the pocketbook is...
Partly it's, you know, the folks that scream the loudest in Washington get the most attention, right? And so, you know, you've got big parts of your base that are concerned about certain issues that the general public just isn't that worried about. You know, I think this is the case with, you know, the inequality issue in particular. I mean, I think that's something that I want to say it's somewhere around 3% is of the public says that that's a top issue for them. But that is, you've certainly seen more than 3% of the news coverage, I think, on that issue. And, you know, that's it's the kind of thing that, you know, we inside the Beltway types just tend to respond to each other a whole lot.
Well, in fairness, if you're a journalist making a modest sum and living in New York or D.C. with lobbyists and hedge fund managers,
right.
It's a very pressing issue. Have you ever tried to get your child into a really good preschool while, like...
Henry's, high income, high earners, not rich yet.
We're not right? rich right. yet.
Yet.
So, Andrew, actually, income mobility, is that a big issue for people, do you think? I mean, is it distinct from income inequality?
I think one of the more interesting things that we've seen over the past year and a half is actually a pivot on the part of Democrats as well, away from some of the from some of this rhetoric around inequality and toward rhetoric around opportunity. I think that's a much more appealing frame to most people, and I think you can't have a conversation about that today without talking about education, and particularly what happens after you graduate from high school.
Realistically, though, how much can we? I mean, I feel like we've been pounding at get more kids through college. We're getting like fewer kids through high school. It's you know, we've been pounding away at this sort of we need more trained workers. Like this is the evergreen from every political campaign forever and ever and ever. What do we do now that's different than what we have, the you know, what's the insanity of trying to do the same thing over and over again and get different results?
Sure, and I think the interesting thing is that both parties have been guilty of that, of this problem, right? So we had, you know, Democrats' natural inclination is to try and solve the problems with schools and colleges from Washington, right? They can't do that. They can pass laws that ask the bureaucracy to write rules that, you know, are supposed to impact the way states and local districts and colleges do their work. George W. Bush fell into the same trap with No Child Left Behind. And this was a very prescriptive attempt to fix schools from D.C. I think that what my colleague Rick Hess and I try to lay out in Room to Grow is a different way of thinking about the federal role. And it is the antithesis of centralizing power over decision making in Washington, and it is to devolve it out to actors who are closer to the problem on the ground, who can actually solve problems, and as Yuval says in his wonderful chapter, allow people to through trial and error figure out better ways to solve the problems that they face in their local area, their school district, and their particular school. Have Washington kind of retreat from that. But bear in mind the need to create space for problem solvers to do their work.
So Yuval, I want to ask, because you've said some great stuff about this, about leaving more space between the federal government mm-hmm. for all sorts of, for local government, for institutions that aren't the government, and viewing, instead of the modern political discourse, we tend to view this, either there's the big federal government, maybe a little bit little state government, and then like everything else is this individual sphere, and there's almost nothing in between. Mm-hmm. And Republicans have long talked a great game about decentralization, devolution, all the rest of it. And yet you look at like what Bush's signature achievements, the Iraq War and No Child Left Behind, which are both these. Yeah. Why, I mean, first of all, why don't Republicans put their money where their mouth is? And how do you change that?
Yeah, I think part of it is thinking beyond this question of devolution exactly. I mean, to me, this also gets to your prior question about the subjects we take up. I think in some ways the place where we can be most useful is not in deciding what subjects ought to be taken up, because that's not up to us anyway, but in thinking about how to approach public problems. And I think there's a great difference between the left and the right in America on the question of how to approach public problems, where there's an inclination on the left, as you say, and it's rooted in progressive thinking that's very interesting and serious, although I think a lot of contemporary progressives don't really wrestle with that thinking very much. That suggests that we ought to think about American society as consisting of individuals and a state, and that the role of the state is to enable those individuals to live the lives they want to lead. This is not a crazy idea, and it's a very appealing idea, but conservatives emphasize what happens in the space between those two, between the individual and the state, where our families are, where our civic institutions are, religious institutions, where the market economy is, and where levels of government below the federal government are. And we emphasize that not just because we don't like the federal government, but rather because it seems to us that that's actually where people thrive, that that's how you solve problems, is hand-to-hand and face-to-face, and that in as much as policy is problem-solving, it's going to have to be able to address people's concerns where they are. And that means that there is an important role for government, but that role for government is a supporting role, it's an enabling role, to enable those institutions in that space between the individual and the state, mediating institutions to help people solve problems they have. And I think if you think about how things happen in that space, conservatives often talk about this in terms of market-oriented policies, and it turns some people off because it seems like we're just saying, just put money in the middle of it and it'll work out. But it's not about money, it's not about markets in that sense. It's about markets as problem-solving mechanisms. And you can think about it quite apart from markets. So if you think about how you solve problems from the bottom up, You allow people to experiment with different solutions. You allow people who need help to choose from among those options, and you allow the options that aren't chosen to fall away, to fail. That's how markets work. It's true. Markets create an enormous economic incentive for things to work that way. There's a huge reason to try new things, to look for little marginal improvements. The consumer has a lot of power and can choose among options the ones that best suits their needs, and things that don't work go away. Government programs don't work this way at all. Regulation does not allow for experimentation. There's a solution, and it's prescribed, generally. The people who are receiving a service don't choose among options, and failures never go away. We just vote for Head Start again, mm-hmm. even though we know, and everybody agrees, that it doesn't work. A lot of what people are calling reform conservatism seems to me to be an effort to move from that latter kind of welfare state model to that former, more market-oriented model. It's not about markets in the sense of money. It's about a way of solving problems that enables those institutions to function, that enables people to try different things, that enables people who need help to choose from among options, and that enable failures to fail. That's what school choice is. That's what the conservative approach to healthcare looks like. That's what our approach to education, to higher education looks like. It's what a lot of our kind of welfare reform ideas look like. And if you think about how would that apply to space X where there's a problem to solve, it seems to me that's more of a way for us to be useful than which problems should we look at and what's the conservative solution. Okay. It's a different way of thinking about how government ought to solve problems.
If I can add, Megan, I just think that this creativity and the markets that Yuval are talking about, I mean, it's just much more in step with the times. It's interesting that I think liberals are really out of step because they've these sort of technocratic, like top-down solutions, right, don't tend to yield the kind of creativity and the kind of flexibility that American consumers tend to enjoy, you know, from the private sector, from civil society. So where, you know, the rest of our lives has become more customizable and leaner and more and much more responsive to individual concerns, government just continues, I think, in this sort of non-responsive, sort of top-down way that is just is not. It's really interesting that you know that conservatism is really where there's room for creativity.
So let me ask you, Ramesh, shifting gears a little bit, but not entirely, is that you know, the big movement in conservatism that has been noticeable in the past few years is the Tea Party, and how much do they contribute to this? You know, where mm-hmm. you've got the establishment versus the Tea Party, right. and is the Tea Party about this kind of like opening up space, experimentation, mm-hmm. et cetera, or are they something simpler and different?
Well, I think that you know, I wouldn't say that reform conservatives or that I myself sort of fall squarely in the Tea Party or the establishment camp on the right. I think each has elements of the truth, but neither's quite there. I think
so. Which group has which element?
Well, I think the party establishment tends to be more realistic about means, the means of achieving things, but sometimes indifferent as to ends. And you've got the reverse set of virtues and vices for the Tea Party. I am struck by the extent to which the division between Tea Partiers and the establishment just doesn't have any policy content to it at all. Mm-hmm. And that I think the Tea Partiers, they have a healthy reaction against the idea of a Republican Party that is just solely about keeping the Fortune 500 happy. But they don't have a lot in the way of ideas about, well, what exactly are we going to do about healthcare? What exactly are we going to do about higher education? But the establishment doesn't either. And so one of the reasons I'm sort of actually hopeful, having just sketched this rather dismal picture of the basic dividing line on the Republican side, but the one reason I'm hopeful is I do think at some point candidates, particularly presidential candidates after an 8-year presidency, have to run on something. And nobody else is offering something, so maybe some of our ideas will catch on.
So I'm going to you just because you're the education guy.
Sure.
And you know, like the youth, you know what the kids these days are up to.
The youth, yeah.
Teens. The youths.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, this has been a big thing, is that the Republicans, what Ramesh was talking about earlier, right, is the idea that increasingly, Democrats are the party of the young, minorities, and single women. Republicans have everyone else. Unfortunately, many of those people
have a very low, very rapid mortality rate in their near future. So is there hope? I mean, is this the sort of thing that actually speaks to the youth vote? Is this the sort of thing where you can actually, because my understanding is that, look, you pick up someone when they're 24, or you pick someone up the first time they vote, you're very likely to have their vote forever. Mm-hmm. So what are the issues that speak to the kids these days?
So I think on the higher ed side in particular, I think it's tough for Republicans now, mainly because Democrats have turned this into student loans in particular and student debt into a campaign issue. And essentially, if you listen, it's at the center of the fair shot agenda, right? Elizabeth Warren, as soon as her refinancing student loan refinancing bill went down, didn't make it through, she went to Kentucky to campaign against Mitch McConnell and said he's siding with millionaires over students. Mm-hmm. And Democrats are giving young college-educated people, they want to give young college-educated people subsidies. This is a strategy we've now seen for two consecutive election seasons, right? We want to give you lower interest rates. We want to allow you to refinance your loans. That's a stimulus package for the college-educated, right? I mean, it's a tough thing to answer on the part of Republicans. I think that there's a population in the middle, sort of not necessarily the youth vote, right? But I'd say like early 20s and mid 20s, people who have some college and no degree, right? They often have debt. They've been sort of let down by this system, and they need something. They need some option that is not as time consuming and not as expensive as a full college degree, and they. They need something. And I think that's a segment of the population. It's big. I mean, it's 20-25% of the country that could easily be wooed by some of the ideas that we talk about in the book. More flexibility, the ability to jump into higher ed and out, right, quickly. When you need new skills, retrain, retool, jump back out. We're going to help you pay for some of that. Those ideas, I think, are very compelling, could be very compelling to that group.
I wanted to jump in on this to make a broader point, which is I think there is a mistake a lot of people who think about politics often make, which is to slice the electorate into these demographic groups in a misleading way. So after the 2012 election, there was a lot of talk about how Republicans were doing poorly among three or four groups in particular: Hispanics, single women, young people, and to a lesser degree, white working class, white voters without college degrees. When you do that, people then jump to thinking there's a group-specific reason that needs to be addressed. So with single women, it's the contraceptive mandate. With Hispanics, it's immigration. With young people, it's same-sex marriage. Those play a role. Absolutely, those play a role. But I think the thing that people often underestimate is that each one of those groups is more economically insecure than the national average. Each of those groups is having trouble getting good jobs, having trouble affording health insurance, in many cases having trouble paying off student loans. Mm-hmm. And each of those groups, when you survey them, they put economics at the top of their list. And so even if you were to solve those group-specific problems, if you don't have a compelling message on the bread and butter concerns, you're going to underperform with each of those groups because they're needier groups.
I mean, it's really interesting to look at, FDR picked up, basically took the African-American vote, which had been much more Republican, and despite the fact that he did nothing on civil rights, right, he picked up a huge proportion of that vote by answering economic needs that they were especially hard hit by the Great Depression. Mm-hmm. And so the feeling that he was doing something about their needs was especially. Yeah.
And I would just the one thing that I would add to that is, especially on the higher ed side, a lot of the policy proposals that Democrats are putting forward are actually fundamentally regressive, right? They reward the college educated, right? They want states to spend more on public higher education, but that doesn't go to students who need it most, right? It goes to the flagship campuses where the smartest kids and the most affluent kids in the state are going, right? I mean, these ideas, so there's a window here for Republicans to sort of call that out and say, this isn't right. We want to do something different.
Okay, I'm going to ask April one last question, then we'll go to Q&A, which is, how much headway is this making in Washington? Do we actually have a reform conservative presidential candidate is coming sometime? You know,
well, I mean, I certainly hope so. And that's certainly one of our goals, I think, is to affect that field, which is bigger by the day. There have been a few champions on the Hill that we take particular we pay particular attention to.
Can you name names?
Yeah, Mike Lee in the Senate has just been a phenomenal idea generator. He's got he's talking about everything from higher ed to taxes to healthcare. So he's just a really phenomenal talent in the Senate. New blood in the Senate. Marco Rubio has been outstanding. Introduced a lot of legislation, is working on more. They're, in fact, I think, teaming up at the moment on a tax proposal that we're looking forward to. Paul Ryan has been doing some good work in the House, so I guess I've named two potential presidential candidates there. We've got guys like that have been around for a long time, too, who are interested in this stuff. Orrin Hatch just gave a great speech on constitutionalism that fits very well into the themes that we have in our book. So I think there's, I think that some of the more talented politicians in Washington are paying attention to this because there's been a vacuum for so long on policy that those who are really interested in trying to, you know, come up with an agenda and move the ball forward, there's just frankly not a lot of places to turn. And we're happy to fill that vacuum, obviously. So, we're encouraged. There's a lot of, I think, interest that's been generated just this book. We didn't expect the kind of attention we got, and I think it was remarkably successful for being a pretty modest effort. But that's what you get when you get smart guys like this working together on a project.
Well, on that happy note, I'm going to open up to the floor. There's a mic that will be circulate, and please speak into the microphone. Also, please raise your hand so that I can call them.
Hi. Thank you so much for coming. This was a really interesting talk. My question is regarding the last topic that you were talking about, specifically about Paul Ryan. So there was an article a little while ago, I can't remember who, it might have been Politico, that was titled, "Is Paul Ryan Too Smart to Run for President?" And the picture of him giving a speech on the House floor with like charts and tables behind him. It's like overall looking very, like, not very like Ted Cruz, like, you know. And I guess my question is that a real trap that, you know, these reform conservatives can fall into, and how do they combat that?
Do voters hate charts?
I'll just say one thing quickly, and I'll turn it over to these guys. But my sense is that the smarter guys who are going to be running for president know that they can't keep doing more of the same. It just hasn't been successful. The last presidential election was there wasn't much of a conservative agenda offered. I think that's fair to say. So I think that those who are looking at, how many cycles has it been now that we haven't won the popular vote? I mean,
five of the last six.
Right. Yeah. You just can't continue this. It's not, the formula's not working. And so I think that the smarter ones are going to realize there's something in common here. We need to develop a more rigorous, agenda. The other thing is I think it's really important that conservatives, because we believe in limited government and we're sort of often portray ourselves as being like anti-government, there's this sense that a lot of folks don't want to get too in the weeds on policy. Like that's like a non-conservative thing to do. If you know too much about HHS, then like we have suspicions about you. And I just think that's wrong. And we've got to confront that, Ryan's got an excellent reputation in the House among his colleagues, and I think that's for good reason. They recognize something in him that is, he's doing the hard work of policymaking and understanding the problems that, we face today and the situation we find ourselves in, which is like a bloated government full of, a gazillion programs that need reform. And somebody's got, if you want to dismantle that, if you want to change that, if you want to reorient that, you've got to understand it. I think Ryan is a popular guy nationwide, with the conservative base. And so I think that intellectualism doesn't concern me.
So no plans to issue Room to Grow as a pop-up book,
say? Listicles.
Yeah, we got exactly. Listicles, yeah.
Slideshow.
Yeah.
Anyone else have the...
I think it's a good question, and it seems to me that... there are a couple of questions it brings up. I think, first of all, that part of what we're trying to do is not so much to find a candidate who will be a champion for these ideas exactly as a whole, but to enrich the policy conversation on the right in general, so that different candidates can take different ideas from among these and can take this way of thinking and try to approach the public with it. I think that it's very strange that the model of Paul Ryan has not been followed by other members of the House. Mm-hmm. It's been incredibly successful for him. It got him on the last presidential ticket. He did it basically by being a nerd. That's what he did, and it's not actually that hard. He picked an issue, became an expert. It took him a while, and he's very smart, but plenty of people are smart, and he decided that he was going to make a name for himself by offering concrete policy ideas. It got him very far, very quick. He's still quite young. He's about to become the most important committee chairman in the House, way out of seniority, because members just think, yeah, of course he should be chairman of Ways and Means. It's strange to me that there are not a lot of other backbenchers who think that way and say, I could become an expert in this or in that. It's clearly a way to shoot up the chain of command among House Republicans. It's not happening a lot. I think it ought to.
Well, it's entirely unprecedented, though, of course. You know, you've got Kemp, who really authored, you know, tax reform from a backbench, not even on the relevant committee, if I remember correctly. Yeah. You've got Jim Talent, who authored welfare reform also, I think, not even on Ways and Means or Energy and Commerce at the time. So it's been done. It can be done. I disagree. I think it is hard. It is hard work. Maybe not for Yuval, but for the rest of us, it's hard work. But, you know, it's what you're elected to do, right? And it certainly is a path, I think, a path to power. So.
Andrew?
I would just say that I've been personally very impressed by his work on education in particular. And I think... To make a broader point, I think April's exactly right, that there's this suspicion of understanding policy details and the nitty-gritty on the right that is sort of bizarre to me. It seems to me to be a critical ingredient of efforts to rein in the federal role in a way that's productive. And if you don't, you know, if all you want to make is blanket claims about doing away with things that never go anywhere, we're not going to get very far.
The first 2 years of the Obama presidency, there was a lot of talk of how, and subsequently too, that the Republicans had become the party of no. I was all for the Republicans defining themselves as the party of no at that time. It was far superior to being defined as the party of me too, but maybe a little bit less. And I think that it became more important to develop an alternative agenda and present it in 2011 and 2012, but it was not crazy for other people to think, you're running against an incumbent president who is contemporary liberalism personified, and it's a referendum on him, and we have to focus the negative case on him. I think that was a mistake. I think there's a lot of evidence that was a mistake. But there would have been a natural tendency to turn towards formulating a positive agenda as you got closer to the end of a two-term presidency. And I think you're going to see that happen. I think you're going to see that happen, for example, with Senator Cruz, who, by the way, is extraordinary in terms of sheer brain power. I mean, you may disagree with him, but listen, I've been arguing with him for 20 years. He's a smart guy. And I expect that he and other people are going to develop a positive agenda over the next couple of months, because it's just kind of, it would just be kind of bizarre to run in 2016 without one.
And there is a lot of ferment. I have to say, I think the last few months have been very different from the last few years, in my own sense. There's a lot of policy ferment on the right. There are more politicians getting to that point in their speech when they should offer something and thinking, I should offer something. Yeah.
It's the first step.
Yeah.
Other questions?
As a Jewish hawk, how much do I have to worry about Rand Paul's influence on foreign policy thinking? Secondly, Pew did a study, it came out a few months ago, found conservatism's never been less popular among young people than it is today. As a Republican, my theory is the fact that we can't stop talking about the 80s. You've mentioned a lot of younger Republicans today. There includes a photo of Ronald Reagan above his head, or above his desk in his office. It's all Reagan. And I don't know how you win younger voters when you can't stop talking about days before some of them were born. Mm-hmm. I was wondering when we're going to move on.
He was great in Bedtime for Bonzo. I know people love that, right?
The kids love that one. I think there is an enormous generational difference among conservatives now. It's becoming more apparent. In some cases, it's a real philosophical difference. Among Republican lawyers, for instance, people over 40 are very, very different from people under 40 and how they think about the Constitution, the role of judges. It's a very interesting thing. But I think even more than that, there's a difference between people who remember the Reagan years and people who know stories about the Reagan years. And on the whole, not in every way, I think that younger conservatives are more constructive and more inclined to think about policy in the ways we're talking about it here, because they're more inclined to think about the present and less inclined to want to repeat the ends of the sentences that people started in the 80s. Mm. The beginnings of those sentences were great, and we should start our sentences that way. We should have the same principles. Mm. We should have the same commitment to the Constitution, the same belief in America, the same optimism. But what it means now has to be a response to what is happening now. That's the first order of business for anyone who wants to think about politics. And I do think that is changing some among younger conservatives, but it's going to take a while.
The LAs and the LDs, the chief deputy chiefs of staff and the staff directors think that way, but the principals don't. Yeah. I don't see how we're going to do better with younger people.
Yeah.
Well, you know, nature has a way of dealing with that. Those LDs are going somewhere.
Are you saying they're going to be culled? Is that
culled? You know, evolution is how I like to think about it. I think that a generational shift takes time, naturally. That's what it is. But the fact that it's the younger people who are thinking more creatively and the older people are not is a good thing. Because among the Democrats, for example, I think the opposite is happening. There are still a lot of people who remember why the new Democrats were necessary and maybe are themselves kind of in that mold still. Younger liberals tend not to be that way, and they're a lot less realistic and a lot less constructive. I'd rather be in the situation of conservatives at this point, looking to the future, than liberals on the whole.
I was just going to add to that. I think that there's a dimension to this sort of crony capitalist corporate welfare side of this debate that I think could appeal to people who would normally maybe shade to the left to say, hey, wait, and this has been a big talking
point. Yeah, I wanted to get to that. So
yeah,
I apologize.
Right. Tim Carney has been all over this, and Jim Petticukis, our colleague and our colleagues. And that to me is just this natural issue for people who are sort of suspicious by nature of big business, right, to sort of line up behind some of that stuff. So I don't, you know, I'm not as pessimistic, I would say.
I am an unapologetic invoker of Reagan. He was the most successful Republican president of the last century, more politically successful than any president since him, in the sense that, you know, look, our last three presidents have all taken office with Congress in control, their party in control of Congress, and left office with their party completely out of control of Congress, and the White House flipping as well. So we should learn from him, but we should learn from the real Reagan, not the mythological Reagan. Mm. And one of the points Steve Hayward makes, he's written a two-volume history of Reagan and his times, is that Reagan rarely made it a big selling point with the public at large that he had a program that conformed to conservative philosophy, even though it largely did. He had a program that developed from conservative philosophy, but he advertised it to the public on the basis of its practical advantages to them. You're going to have lower crime rate, lower inflation, you're not going to face bracket creep, and so on and so forth. And I think a lot of today's Reagan invokers don't follow his example. They just drop his name.
They're much more concerned with ideological purity, you know, and sort of, I think, maintaining, you know, the standard. I mean, this.
Whereas Reagan was an innovator,
right? And I mean, it also goes to what Ramesh was talking about, where there's, you know, this difference between the Tea Party and the establishment. I mean, so much of this is tactical and, you know, and attitudinal. You know, and unfortunately, we've gotten to this place where a lot of our conservative standard bearers, the people who, you know, once came up with many of the ideas that we ran on, you know, are much more concerned with these tactical fights than they are with, you know, developing policy anymore. So it's an interesting.
Right, and that's how you end up with the debate season we had in the presidential primaries last time, where a lot of the time it's a competition, just who can say it louder.
Mm-hmm. Right. You could call it the party of Goldwater versus the party of Reagan, the party of grand soaring speeches about liberty versus the party of actually talking about people and how all of this affected them individually.
Yeah, I mean, it was also really uninteresting, I think. Yes. You know, I mean, for people who were interested in policy, it was just really uninteresting. It wasn't creative. There wasn't, you know, the kind
of
energy.
999 is the biggest policy proposal being made.
Right.
It's not a good sign.
Other questions? I'll keep asking them if you, oh no, we've got plenty over here. You.
Thank you. The book mentions making tax cuts for families where they need them most. So what would that look like in practice? And do you think there's any room for maybe incentives for mothers who want to stay at home to raise their children, incentives for families to operate economically in the way that they see fit, instead of punishing women who want to stay home, women or men who want to stay home and have single income families?
Well, you know, the cost of raising families has increased, and the tax code does, I think, a very poor job of recognizing the extent to which raising children is an investment in the future. I mean, we say that as a kind of rote sentiment, but it actually is financially, in part, an investment in the future of the country and on our future taxpayers, and I think the tax code ought to recognize that fact. I don't believe that we should be providing incentives for mothers or fathers to stay home with the kids. I do think we should be enabling families to make the decisions they want to make. Whether that is, you know, a lot of government subsidies in the childcare area flow towards commercial daycare. That is something that a lot of families like to use. However, it is in general the least favored form of childcare for American families. And I would say if you expand the child credit, which is a very popular proposal with almost every group in the American public, you are allowing people to make these decisions. Does one parent want to scale back to part-time work and spend more time with the family? Do they want to use it to purchase childcare? Do they want to use it to purchase supplementary educational services? You leave those choices up to the families by providing them with tax relief. That is, I think, in a certain sense, a very traditional conservative answer, and it ought to be provided in this form now.
It's an example, too, of where a traditional conservative answer is not being directed to the right question, where the problem that exists now is different from the problem that existed 35 years ago. And when you think about how to provide people with tax relief today, what does middle-class tax relief look like? It doesn't just look like lower marginal tax rates, certainly not just like lower top marginal tax rates. For most people, the payroll tax is a huge tax burden. And for many Americans, almost most, it is the only tax burden they actually have at the federal level. They don't have an income tax liability. But conservatives do not talk about the payroll tax as a target for tax relief. And try to kind of shield it off from conversations about tax cuts and tax reform, it should be right at the center of those discussions. And the fact that it has
just to be clear, the child credit I'm talking about would apply against the payroll tax,
right.
So it would be a form of payroll tax relief.
Exactly. And it's very important in that sense, because you have to talk to people about problems they face, not just about an abstract economy out there that if it's doing better, then by some magic, they'll also do better.
If you get really rich, you're going to be paying much lower top marginal tax rates.
It's a better incentive to get rich. Well, okay. But, you know, there's a tendency in general for conservatives to talk about the economy in very abstract terms. Mm-hmm. It's not crazy. It does matter. Economic growth has to be there as a foundation for everything else to work out. And if we don't have economic growth, then a lot of the other problems we have become much worse, and a lot of the solutions we offer are not sufficient. We do need it. But we also need to help people with the problems they face and to help them understand what we're offering in terms of the problems they face.
YG Network actually commissioned polling on many of the ideas that are found in the book. And it was remarkable on the expanding the child credit. Not only was it just overwhelmingly popular with the public, but with so many of those demographic groups that people wring their hands about, and particularly strategists in Washington wring their hands about, it did really, really well. So, for example, you might not intuitively think that you know, single women would care that much about expanding the child credit for which we've sort of described as being for families, but would certainly be applicable to women who have children without a spouse at home. Wildly popular with single women. Very popular with minority groups. It's one of those questions that gets to those economic concerns that underlie a lot of the insecurities that are felt most acutely by these demographic groups that we worry about as, you know, in electoral politics.
We had another question. We actually have two in the back row, but the one on the right first, I guess. Totally ignore the land.
This is about the conservative anti-intellectualism you were talking about earlier. So excuse my interpretation of what you were saying, but what I heard was that the market encourages students to go off to colleges dominated by liberal thinkers and getting sort of degrees in things that aren't very important. So what would you say the correction for that is, whether or not that's an accurate depiction of what's actually happening?
So, well, I think that's a fine paraphrase of what I said. I would probably only add to that I think part of the problem is that people can't tell what the value of a particular degree is and what it's, you know, whether it's going to pay off in the long run down the line, partly because we don't have that information readily available to them. So, you know, markets are such that there are always going to be people who want to buy that silly major, right? I mean, people are going to just do it. I think that Republican governors, for instance, one in Florida comes to mind, have sort of made a mistake about making this. We want more STEM majors and we want less anthropologists, right? To me, that sounds like, you know, I said this at the time, that sounds more like, you know, central planning in Bucharest, right, or than it does like a market-based response. But I would say, so what I would say is that what I think the federal government should aim to do is to inform consumers in a way that allows them to make judgments about the product that they're investing in. And simultaneously to lower barriers to entry to let in new providers who are offering a different product. Right now, the accreditation system, the accreditors that come to accredit UChicago, they probably go to accredit Chicago State, right? It's probably the same group. They both probably bear the same seal of approval. At the same time, so it keeps Chicago State in business. It's not a very good college. At the same time, it keeps out somebody who would want to compete with UChicago or with Chicago State that may be offering something different, that may not be staffed by traditional faculty. These are examples of the policies that have been in place for a long time that are actually preventing consumers from making informed choices and from competition and preventing competition from taking root in this market in a way that that drives costs down and drives quality up. So.
In the back row, there was another gentleman.
This question is somewhat related to that one and primarily is directed to Mr. Kelly. You had said earlier on that part of the problem with higher education is that students are often choosing to study things or forced to study things that don't make any sense. They're studying nonsense. I think you said, fill their heads with nonsense. I guess part of my question is, how is it that students starting out can distinguish between things that are nonsense and ideas that really matter, particularly in the liberal arts or certain areas of social sciences, where part of the purpose of education is to be able to make those kinds of distinctions to begin with. Mm-hmm. So I guess my worry is that conservatives take too much of a market-driven approach. I mean, you talked about making investments in majors to see how they pay off, but I was wondering if there was anything within sort of reform conservatism that recognizes the intrinsic value of knowledge and the potential non-market values of knowledge, mm-hmm. and that having sort of market-driven solutions could degrade and devalue the very important non-market values that come with higher education.
Yeah. Speaking as an English major, I really want to hear the answer.
Yes. Yeah, so I should have prefaced my comment about nonsense by saying that I was a history major and took plenty of classes that didn't really equip me to be a think tank wonk like I am now. So I'm not one who chose super rationally what they were going to do with their time in college. What I would say though is that I think there's a distinction. So where I would draw the line is there's a distinction between what the government is going to subsidize and spend money on, and especially in the case of student loans, right? as a lender, the federal government wants to ensure that the money that they're lending out gets paid back, right? That's the fiduciary responsibility of the taxpayers. I think above and beyond that, a market would reward, a proper market would reward a lot of the non-pecuniary benefits of higher ed that you're describing, because people will have tastes for that. So I think those things would still exist, but I think as a taxpayer, the question that I have is whether I'm subsidizing and lending money to people to study things that I'm going to wind up being on the hook for when they default. So that's where I would draw the line. I think taxpayers have a slightly different interest than students themselves. I think you raise an excellent point. We shouldn't lose sight of the fact that education is about more than just earning power. It's about creating an educated citizenry. It's about creating art and music and all sorts of other wonderful things. I just get concerned when the federal policies that we have currently encourage investment in any program at any price, and don't distinguish between things that have value in the labor market and don't.
I have a slightly different perspective from Andrew, but I think one that's complementary. I think that maybe the biggest problem with the way our society and our government approaches higher education is that we essentially tell people that if they don't go to a traditional four-year collegiate institution, they're losers, especially economically. They're not going to be successful. And I think that is a misguided, inefficient, and just plain cruel approach. And one of the secondary problems that have arisen from it, I don't think it has done no favors to the ideal of a liberal arts education. And so I think not only do we need to keep in mind that knowledge and reflection are intrinsic goods, I think actually, in a way, decoupling the economic imperatives from these institutions actually ends up helping.
Yeah, let me say too, I entirely agree with that, and I think that it's important to see that people who want to defend the liberal arts, and I would say I studied political philosophy in college, and then to become more practical went to the Committee on Social Thought at the University of Chicago. I have a lot of experience with people calling things nonsense. I don't think that academics who worry about liberal education think enough about the fact that the insanity of the business model of the university is a huge problem for them. The fact that we now have a system that is economically unsustainable and so under constant economic pressure means they're the first to go. The fact is liberal arts education is understood by our society as something like a luxury item. That's a mistake to some extent. It's not entirely a mistake. I think even if you think properly about the place of a true liberal education in the life of a democracy, I'm in agreement with Tocqueville that it is something that will interest a few, and it is very important that those few have access to great education. It is not what everybody will be interested in, and that's okay. The question is, how are those few going to have access to great liberal education? And I don't think it's going to be in a system that is under the kind of pressure that our higher education system is under now. And part of what we're talking about when it comes to reforming higher ed is to make the system more sustainable by making it answer people's needs and wants better than it does now. Some of those wants are going to involve higher education and liberal education. And the kind of liberal education that you would get here and in other elite places is very important to some people. And that means that it is a market that will be served. And we shouldn't simply think of it as a market in economic terms, but I don't think of markets in general in purely economic terms. Mm-hmm. Markets are ways of allocating resources and allowing people to find what they want. And some of what people want is this kind of, an educated citizenry, and B, personally, access to truth and to beauty and to the sorts of things that a lot of people at this university seek. I think that today's higher education system is the enemy of those people, and they need to see that. They're going to be the ones who have to go first, and the kinds of solutions that Andrew offers, I think, could be very good for liberal education. They don't involve rejecting that as an option. They involve allowing people to seek what they want and to make it sustainable economically. There's no getting away from economics when we talk about higher education, after all.
I think it's going to be the last question, and since we haven't sir.
Here in Cook County, we had the lowest voter, the last election, we had the lowest voter turnout in about 70 years. This was echoed other places in the country, especially if we're talking about a market approach. How do we know what citizens want if so few of them are participating in the process? How can we really make accurate statements about what we're going to do in the future or where we're going to go if so few people are interested in participating?
Would we know even if they did participate? Anyone want to?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think our democratic system is a way of legitimating government power, which is essential. It's necessary. It's why our government is a legitimate government. It's not necessarily a way of figuring out what everybody wants. There are other ways. It's one of the ways we have for figuring out what everybody wants. Other ways include markets. Other ways include everything we do in society. They're all ways of pursuing what we're after. Obviously, our political system, well, maybe it's not obvious, but to my mind, our political system would work a lot better if more people participated. And I think higher voter participation should be a goal. I think Republicans have been very bad about this and have at least allowed a lot of the public to have the impression that they want fewer people to vote, which is nuts, and shouldn't be what they want. That's not to say that if everybody voted, we would know what everybody wants. You know, you're voting among two options, neither of which is what probably anybody wants. So our system is never going to be a way of answering that question. But it is a way of answering some very important questions about what our government should look like, and I think more people should be involved in offering those answers. And, you know, people in public life should want that, should want more people to be involved and more people to be voting, and that should be everybody's goal in a democracy.
I would just add to that, I think this is partly why it's critical, why some of the market-based ideas are critical for people being able to express their preferences. Because if you have, you know, if you have low voter turnout and a party, you know, one party wins, and they happen to be a party that wants to impose the one-size-fits-all policy option, you know, uniformly across the entire population, you have a huge segment of the population that, yes, maybe they didn't come out and vote, but now they're being stuck with something that doesn't necessarily match their preferences. And I think it's just another avenue, you know, market-based social policy is another avenue for people to vote with their feet and have their preferences met by the government.
I mean, Obamacare is a great example of this. It's never had majority support in the country. Never has, right?
And to close the loop with something we were saying, talking about earlier, to the extent that Washington and the political class in general is talking about things that are of intense interest to the political class, but not as much to the public at large, I think there becomes less of a reason for people to get interested and vote because they're not being offered anything that, that makes them want to get up.
Yeah. None of the above is not a crazy decision in our political system.
It's our goal, I think, should be growing our total numbers, right? I mean, when you hear a lot about, you know, that we need to win more women or we need to win, you know, more whatever segment of the population. I mean, my response to this is always, you know, no, we just need more. Like, we just need more votes. It doesn't really matter where they come from. And one of the most obvious ways to do that is just to grow the pie. And I think there's just a lot of votes out there that we're not asking for. So.
Well, on that note, I think this has been a great panel, and thanks to all of you guys for talking about this for an hour and 15 minutes.
Thank you.
All presidential candidates there. You know, we've got guys like that have been around for a long time, too, who are interested in this stuff. Orrin Hatch just gave a great speech on constitutionalism that fits very well into the themes that we have in our book. So I think there's, I think that some of the more talented politicians in Washington are paying attention to this because there's been a vacuum for so long on policy that those who are really interested in trying to, you know, come up with an agenda and move the ball forward, there's just frankly not a lot of places to turn. And we're happy to fill that vacuum, obviously. So, you know, look, we're encouraged. There's a lot of, I think, interest that's been generated just this book. We didn't expect the kind of attention we got. And I think it was, you know, remarkably successful for being a pretty modest effort, but that's what you get when you get smart guys like this working together on a project.
Well, on that happy note, I'm going to open up to the floor. There's a mic that will be circulate, and please speak into the microphone. Also, please raise your hand so that I can call them.
Hi.
Thank you so much for coming. This was a really interesting talk. My question is regarding the last topic that you were talking about, specifically about Paul Ryan. So there was an article a little while ago, I can't remember who, it might have been Politico, that was, you know, titled, "Is Paul Ryan Too Smart to Run for President?" And the picture of him giving a speech on the House floor with, like, charts and tables behind him. It's like, overall looking very, like, not very, like, Ted Cruz, like, you know. And I guess my question is that a real trap that, you know, these reform conservatives can fall into, and how do they combat that?
Do voters hate charts?
I'll just say one thing quickly, and I'll turn it over to these guys. But my sense is that the smarter guys who are going to be running for president know that they can't keep doing more of the same. It just hasn't been successful. The last presidential election was there wasn't much of a conservative agenda offered. I think that's fair to say. So I think that those who are looking at, you know, the How many cycles has it been now that we haven't won the popular vote? I mean,
five of the last six.
Right. Yeah. You know, you just can't continue this. It's not the formula is not working. And so I think that the smarter ones are going to realize there's something in common here. We need to develop a more rigorous agenda. The other thing is I think it's really important that conservatives. You know, because we believe in limited government and we're sort of often portray ourselves as being like anti-government, there's this sense that a lot of folks don't want to get too in the weeds on policy. Like that's like a non-conservative thing to do. If you know too much about HHS, then like we have suspicions about you. And I just think that's wrong. And we've got to confront that, you know. Ryan's got an excellent reputation in the House among his colleagues, and I think that's for good reason. They recognize something in him that is, you know, he's doing the hard work of policymaking and understanding the problems that, you know, we face today and the situation we find ourselves in, which is like a bloated government full of, you know, a gazillion programs that need reform. And somebody's got, I mean, if you want to dismantle that, if you want to change that, if you want to reorient that, you've got to understand it. I think Ryan is a popular guy nationwide, you know, with the conservative base. And so I think that that intellectualism doesn't concern me.
So no plans to issue Room to Grow as a pop-up book,
say? Listicles.
Yeah, we got exactly. Listicles, yeah.
Slideshow.
Yeah.
Anyone else have the...
I think it's a good question, and it seems to me that there are a couple of questions it brings up. I think, first of all, that part of what we're trying to do is not so much to find a candidate who will be a champion for these ideas exactly as a whole, but to enrich the policy conversation on the right in general so that different candidates can take different ideas from among these and can take this way of thinking and try to approach the public with it. I think that it's very strange that the model of Paul Ryan has not been followed by other members of the House. Mm-hmm. It's been incredibly successful for him. It got him on the last presidential ticket. He did it basically by being a nerd. That's what he did, and it's not actually that hard. He picked an issue, became an expert. It took him a while, and he's very smart, but plenty of people are smart, and he decided that he was going to make a name for himself by offering concrete policy ideas. It got him very far, very quick. He's still quite young. He's about to become the most important committee chairman in the House, way out of seniority, because members just think, yeah, of course he should be chairman of Ways and Means. It's strange to me that there are not a lot of other backbenchers who think that way and say, I could become an expert in this or in that. It's clearly a way to shoot up the chain of command among House Republicans. It's not happening a lot. I think it ought to.
Well, it's not entirely unprecedented, though, of course. You know, you've got Kemp, who really authored, you know, tax reform from a backbench, not even on the relevant committee, if I remember correctly. Yep. You've got Jim Talent, who authored welfare reform also, I think, not even on Ways and Means or Energy and Commerce at the time. So it's been done. It can be done. I disagree. I think it is hard. It is hard work. Maybe not for Yuval, but for the rest of us, it's hard work. But, you know, it's what you're elected to do, right? And it certainly is a path, I think, a path to power. So,
Andrew?
I would just say that I've been personally very impressed by his work on education in particular. And I think... To make a broader point, I think April's exactly right, that there's this suspicion of understanding policy details and the nitty-gritty on the right that is sort of bizarre to me. It seems to me to be a critical ingredient of efforts to rein in the federal role in a way that's productive. And if you don't, you know, if all you want to make is blanket claims about doing away with things that never go anywhere, we're not going to get very far.
The first 2 years of the Obama presidency, there was a lot of talk of how, and subsequently too, that the Republicans had become the party of no. I was all for the Republicans defining themselves as the party of no at that time. It was far superior to being defined as the party of me too, but maybe a little bit less. And I think that it became more important to develop an alternative agenda and present it in 2011 and 2012, but it was not crazy for other people to think you're running against an incumbent president who is contemporary liberalism personified, and it's a referendum on him, and we have to focus the negative case on him. I think that was a mistake. I think there's a lot of evidence that was a mistake. But there would have been a natural tendency to turn towards formulating a positive agenda as you got closer to the end of a two-term presidency. And I think you're going to see that happen. I think you're going to see that happen, for example, with Senator Cruz, who, by the way, is extraordinary in terms of sheer brain power. I mean, you may disagree with him, but listen, I've been arguing with him for 20 years. He's a smart guy. And I expect that he and other people are going to develop a positive agenda over the next couple of months, because it's just kind of, it would just be kind of bizarre to run in 2016 without one.
And there is a lot of ferment. I have to say, I think the last few months have been very different from the last few years, in my own sense. There's a lot of policy ferment on the right. There are more politicians getting to that point in their speech when they should offer something and thinking, I should offer something. Yeah.
It's the first step.
Yeah.
Other questions?
As a Jewish hawk, how much do I have to worry about Rand Paul's influence on foreign policy thinking? Secondly, Pew did a study, it came out a few months ago, found conservatism's never been less popular among young people than it is today. As a Republican, my theory is the fact that you can't stop talking about the 80s. You've mentioned a lot of Republican, younger Republicans today. There includes a photo of Ronald Reagan above his head, or above his desk in his office. It's all Reagan. And I don't know how you win younger voters when you can't stop talking about days before some of them were even born. Mm-hmm. I was wondering when we're going to move on.
Mm-hmm. He was great in Bedtime for Bonzo. I know people love that, right?
The kids love that one. I think there is an enormous generational difference among conservatives now. It's becoming more apparent. In some cases, it's a real philosophical difference. Among Republican lawyers, for instance, people over 40 are very, very different from people under 40 in how they think about the Constitution, the role of judges. It's a very interesting thing. But I think even more than that, there's a difference between people who remember the Reagan years and people who know stories about the Reagan years. And on the whole, not in every way, I think that younger conservatives are more constructive and more inclined to think about policy in the ways we're talking about it here, because they're more inclined to think about the present and less inclined to want to repeat the ends of the sentences that people started in the 80s. Mm. The beginnings of those sentences were great, and we should start our sentences that way. We should have the same principles. We should have the same commitment to the Constitution, the same belief in America, the same optimism. But what it means now has to be a response to what is happening now. That's the first order of business for anyone who wants to think about politics. And I do think that is changing some among younger conservatives, but it's going to take a while.
The LAs and the LDs, the chief deputy chief of staff, and the staff directors think that way, but the principals don't. And I don't see how we're going to do better with younger people.
Yeah.
Well, you know, nature has a way of dealing with that. Those LDs are going somewhere.
Are you saying they're going to be culled? Is that
culled? You know, evolution is how I like to think about it. I think that a generational shift takes time, naturally. That's what it is. But the fact that it's the younger people who are thinking more creatively and the older people are not is a good thing. Because among the Democrats, for example, I think the opposite is happening. There are still a lot of people who remember why the new Democrats were necessary and maybe are themselves kind of in that mold still. Younger liberals tend not to be that way, and they're a lot less realistic and a lot less constructive. I'd rather be in the situation of conservatives at this point, looking to the future, than looking at this on the whole.
I was just going to add to that. I think that there's a dimension to this sort of crony capitalist corporate welfare side of this debate that I think could appeal to people who would normally maybe shade to the left to say, hey, wait, and this has been a big talking
point. Yeah, I didn't get to, I wanted to get to that. So
yeah,
I
right. This, I mean, Tim Carney has been all over this, and Jim Petticoukas, our colleague and our colleagues, and that to me is just this natural issue for people who are sort of suspicious by nature of big business, right, to sort of line up behind some of that stuff. So I don't, you know, I'm not as pessimistic, I would say.
I am an unapologetic invoker of Reagan. He was the most successful Republican president of the last century, more politically successful than any president since him, in the sense that, you know, look, our last three presidents have all taken office with Congress in control, their party in control of Congress, and left office with their party completely out of control of Congress, and the White House flipping as well. So we should learn from him, but we should learn from the real Reagan, not the mythological Reagan. Mm. And one of the points Steve Hayward makes, he's written a two-volume history of Reagan and his times, is that Reagan rarely made it a big selling point with the public at large that he had a program that conformed to conservative philosophy, even though it largely did. He had a program that developed from conservative philosophy, but he advertised it to the public on the basis of its practical advantages to them. You're going to have lower crime rate, lower inflation, you're not going to face bracket creep, and so on and so forth. And I think a lot of today's Reagan invokers don't follow his example. They just drop his name.
They're much more concerned with ideological purity, you know, and sort of, I think, maintaining, you know, the standard. I mean, this.
Whereas Reagan was an innovator,
right? And I mean, it also goes to what Ramesh was talking about, where there's, you know, this difference between the Tea Party and the establishment. I mean, so much of this is tactical and, you know, and attitudinal. You know, and unfortunately, we've gotten to this place where a lot of our conservative standard bearers, the people who, you know, once came up with many of the ideas that we ran on, you know, are much more concerned with these tactical fights than they are with, you know, developing policy anymore. So it's you know, it's an interesting.
Right, and that's how you end up with the debate season we had in the presidential primaries last time, where a lot of the time it's a competition just who can say it louder.
Mm-hmm. Right. You could call it the party of Goldwater versus the party of Reagan, the party of grand soaring speeches about liberty versus the party of actually talking about people and how all of this affected them individually.
Yeah, I mean, it was also really uninteresting, I think. Yes. You know, I mean, for people who were interested in policy, it was just really uninteresting. It wasn't creative. There wasn't, you know, the kind
of
energy.
999 is the biggest policy proposal being made.
Right.
It's not a good sign.
Other questions? I'll keep asking them if you... Oh, no, we've got plenty over here. You.
Thank you. The book mentions making tax cuts for families where they need them most. So what would that look like in practice? And do you think there's any room for maybe incentives for mothers who want to stay at home to raise their children, incentives for families to operate economically in the way that they see fit, instead of punishing women who want to stay home, women or men who want to stay home and have single income families?
Well, you know, the cost of raising families has increased, and the tax code does, I think, a very poor job of recognizing the extent to which raising children is an investment in the future. I mean, we say that as a kind of rote sentiment, but it actually is financially, in part, an investment in the future of the country and on our future taxpayers, and I think the tax code ought to recognize that fact. I don't believe that we should be providing incentives for mothers or fathers to stay home with the kids. I do think we should be enabling families to make the decisions they want to make, whether that is, you know, a lot of government subsidies in the childcare area flow towards commercial daycare. That is something that a lot of families like to use. However, it is in general the least favored form of childcare for American families. And I would say if you expand the child credit, which is a very popular proposal with almost every group in the American public, you are allowing people to make these decisions. Does one parent want to scale back to part-time work and spend more time with the family? Do they want to use it to purchase childcare? Do they want to use it to purchase supplementary educational services? You leave those choices up to the families by providing them with tax relief. That is, I think, in a certain sense, a very traditional conservative answer, and it ought to be provided in this form now.
It's an example, too, of where a traditional conservative answer is not being directed to the right question, where the problem that exists now is different from the problem that existed 35 years ago. And when you think about how to provide people with tax relief today, what does middle class tax relief look like? It doesn't just look like lower marginal tax rates, certainly not just like lower top marginal tax rates. For most people, the payroll tax is a huge tax burden. And for many Americans, almost most, it is the only tax burden they actually have at the federal level. They don't have an income tax liability. But conservatives do not talk about the payroll tax as a target for tax relief and try to kind of shield it off from conversations about tax cuts and tax reform. It should be right at the center of those discussions. And the fact that it has
an important... Just to be clear, the child credit I'm talking about would apply against the payroll tax,
right.
So it would be a form of payroll tax relief.
Exactly. And it's very important in that sense, because you have to talk to people about problems they face, not just about an abstract economy out there that if it's doing better, then by some magic, they'll also do better.
If you get really rich, you're going to be paying much lower top marginal tax rates.
It's a better incentive to get rich. Well, okay. But... there's a tendency in general for conservatives to talk about the economy in very abstract terms. Mm-hmm. It's not crazy. It does matter. Economic growth has to be there as a foundation for everything else to work out. And if we don't have economic growth, then a lot of the other problems we have become much worse, and a lot of the solutions we offer are not sufficient. We do need it. But we also need to help people with the problems they face and to help them understand what we're offering in terms of the problems they face. Mm-hmm.
YG Network actually commissioned polling on many of the ideas that are found in the book. And it was remarkable on the expanding the child credit. Not only was it just overwhelmingly popular with the public, but with so many of those demographic groups that people wring their hands about, and particularly strategists in Washington wring their hands about, it did really, really well. So for example, you might not intuitively think that single women would care that much about expanding the child credit as we've sort of described as being for families, but would certainly be applicable to women who have children without a spouse at home. Wildly popular with single women, very popular with minority groups. It's one of those questions that gets to those economic concerns that underlie a lot of the insecurities that are felt most acutely by these demographic groups that we worry about is, in electoral politics.
We had another question. We actually have two in the back row, but the one on the right first.
We totally ignored the question.
This is about the conservative anti-intellectualism you were talking about earlier. So excuse my interpretation of what you were saying, but what I heard was that the market encourages students to go off to colleges dominated by liberal thinkers and getting sort of degrees in things that aren't very important. So what would you say the correction for that is, whether or not that's an accurate depiction of what's actually happening?
So, I think that's a fine paraphrase of what I said. I would probably only add to that I think part of the problem is that people can't tell what the value of a particular degree is, and what it's whether it's going to pay off in the long run down the line. Partly because we don't have that information readily available to them. So, markets are such that there are always going to be people who want to buy that silly major, right? I mean, people are going to just do it. I think that Republican governors, for instance, one in Florida comes to mind, have sort of made a mistake about making this, we want more STEM majors and we want less anthropologists, right? To me, that sounds like, I said this at the time, that sounds more like, central planning in Bucharest, right? Or than it does like a market-based response. But I would say, what I think the federal government should aim to do is to inform consumers in a way that allows them to make judgments about the product that they're investing in, and simultaneously to lower barriers to entry to let in new providers who are offering a different product. Right now, the accreditation system, the accreditors that come to accredit UChicago, they probably go to accredit Chicago State, right? It's probably the same group. They both probably bear the same seal of approval. At the same time, so it keeps Chicago State in business. It's not a very good college. At the same time, it keeps out somebody who would want to compete with UChicago or with Chicago State that may be offering something different, that may not be staffed by traditional faculty. These are examples of the policies that have been in place for a long time that are actually preventing consumers from making informed choices and from competition and preventing competition from taking root in this market in a way that that drives costs down and drives quality up.
In the back row, there was another gentleman.
This question is somewhat related to that one and primarily is directed to Mr. Kelly. You had said earlier on that part of the problem with higher education is that students are often choosing to study things or forced to study things that don't make any sense. They're studying nonsense. I think you said, fill their heads with nonsense. I guess part of my question is, how is it that students starting out can distinguish between things that are nonsense and ideas that really matter, particularly in the liberal arts or certain areas of social sciences, where part of the purpose of education is to be able to make those kinds of distinctions to begin with. Mm-hmm. So I guess my worry is that conservatives take too much of a market-driven approach. I mean, you talked about making investments in majors to see how they pay off, but I was wondering if there was anything within sort of reform conservatism that recognizes the intrinsic value of knowledge and the potential non-market values of knowledge, mm-hmm. and that having sort of market-driven solutions could degrade and devalue the very important non-market values that come with higher education.
Yeah. Speaking as an English major, I really want to hear the answer.
Yeah, so I should have prefaced my comment about nonsense by saying that I was a history major and took plenty of classes that didn't really equip me to be a think tank wonk like I am now. So I'm not one who chose super rationally what they were going to do with their time in college. What I would say though is that I think there's a distinction. So where I would draw the line is there's a distinction between what the government is going to subsidize and spend money on.
Institutions are religious institutions, where the market economy is, and where levels of government below the federal government are. And we emphasize that not just because we don't like the federal government, but rather because it seems to us that that's actually where people thrive, that that's how you solve problems, is hand-to-hand and face-to-face, and that in as much as policy is problem-solving, it's going to have to be able to address people's concerns where they are. And that means that there is an important role for government, but that role for government is a supporting role, it's an enabling role, to enable those institutions in that space between the individual and the state, mediating institutions to help people solve problems they have. And I think if you think about how things happen in that space, conservatives often talk about this in terms of market-oriented policies, and it turns some people off because it seems like we're just saying, just put money in the middle of it and it'll work out. But it's not about money, it's not about markets in that sense. It's about markets as problem-solving mechanisms. And you can think about it quite apart from markets. So if you think about how you solve problems from the bottom up, you allow people to experiment with different solutions, you allow people who need help to choose from among those options, and you allow the options that aren't chosen to fall away, to fail. That's how markets work, it's true. Markets create an enormous economic incentive for things to work that way. There's a huge reason to try new things, to look for little marginal improvements. The consumer has a lot of power and can choose among options the ones that best suits their needs, and things that don't work go away. Government programs don't work this way at all. Regulation does not allow for experimentation. There's a solution and it's prescribed generally. The people who are receiving a service don't choose among options, and failures never go away. We just vote for Head Start again, mm-hmm. even though we know and everybody agrees that it doesn't work. A lot of what people are calling reform conservatism seems to me to be an effort to move from that latter kind of welfare state model to that former, more market-oriented model. It's not about markets in the sense of money. It's about a way of solving problems that enables those institutions to function, that enables people to try different things, that enables people who need help to choose from among options, and that enable failures to fail. That's what school choice is. That's what the conservative approach to healthcare looks like. That's what our approach to education, to higher education, looks like. It's what a lot of our kind of welfare reform ideas look like. And if you think about how would that apply to SpaceX, where there's a problem to solve, it seems to me that's more of a way for us to be useful than which problems should we look at and what's the conservative solution. Okay. It's a different way of thinking about how government ought to solve problems.
If I can add, Megan, I just think that this creativity and the markets that Yuval is talking about, I mean, it's just much more in step with the times. It's interesting that I think liberals are really out of step because they've these sort of technocratic, like top-down solutions, right, don't tend to yield the kind of creativity and the kind of flexibility that American consumers tend to enjoy, you know, from the private sector, from civil society. So where, you know, the rest of our lives has become more customizable and leaner and more and much more responsive to individual concerns, government just continues, I think, in this sort of non-responsive, sort of top-down way that is just is not. It's really interesting that you know that conservatism is really where there's room for creativity.
So let me ask you, Ramesh, shifting gears a little bit, but not entirely, is that you know, the big movement in conservatism that has been noticeable in the past few years is the Tea Party, and how much do they contribute to this? You know, where you've got the establishment versus the Tea Party, right. and is the Tea Party about this kind of like opening up space, experimentation, et cetera, or are they something simpler and different?
Well, I think that you know, I wouldn't say that reform conservatives or that I myself sort of fall squarely in the Tea Party or the establishment camp on the right. I think each has elements of the truth. But neither's quite there. I think
so. Which group has which element?
Well, I think the party establishment tends to be more realistic about means, the means of achieving things, but sometimes indifferent as to ends. And you've got the reverse set of virtues and vices for the Tea Party. I am struck by the extent to which the division between Tea Partiers and the establishment just doesn't have any policy content to it at all. Mm-hmm. And that I think the Tea Partiers, they have a healthy reaction against the idea of a Republican Party that is just solely about keeping the Fortune 500 happy. But they don't have a lot in the way of ideas about, well, what exactly are we going to do about healthcare? What exactly are we going to do about higher education? But the establishment doesn't either. And so one of the reasons I'm sort of actually hopeful, having just sketched this rather dismal picture of the basic dividing line on the Republican side, but the one reason I'm hopeful is I do think at some point candidates, particularly presidential candidates after an 8-year presidency, have to run on something. And nobody else is offering something, so maybe some of our ideas will catch on.
So I'm going to you just because you're the education guy,
sure.
And you know, like the youth. I figure you know what the kids these days are up
to.
The youth,
yeah. Teens,
the youths.
Yeah. So
you know, this has been a big thing. Is that the Republicans? What Ramesh was talking about earlier, right? Is the idea that increasingly Democrats are the party of the young, minorities, and single women. Republicans have everyone else. Unfortunately, many of those people have a very low, very rapid mortality rate in their near future. So is there hope? I mean, is this the sort of thing that actually speaks to the youth vote? Is this the sort of thing where you can actually, because my understanding is that, look, you pick up someone when they're 24, or you pick someone up the first time they vote, you're very likely to have their vote forever. Mm-hmm. So what are the issues that speak to the kids these days?
So I think, so on the higher ed side in particular, I think it's tough for Republicans now, mainly because Democrats have turned this into student loans in particular and student debt into a campaign issue. And essentially, if you listen, you know, it's at the center of the Fair Shot agenda, right? Elizabeth Warren, as soon as her refinancing, student loan refinancing bill went down, didn't make it through, she went to Kentucky to campaign against Mitch McConnell and said he's siding with millionaires over students. Mm-hmm. And Democrats are giving young college-educated people, they want to give young college-educated people subsidies. This is a strategy we've now seen for two consecutive election seasons, right? We want to give you lower interest rates. We want to allow you to refinance your loans. That's a stimulus package for the college educated, right? I mean, it's a tough thing to answer on the part of Republicans. I think that there's a population in the middle, sort of not necessarily the youth vote, right? But I'd say like early 20s and mid 20s, people who have some college and no degree, right? They often have debt. They've been sort of let down by this system, and they need something. They need some option that is not as time-consuming and not as expensive as a full college degree, and they need something. And I think that's a segment of the population. It's big. I mean, it's 20-25% of the country that could easily be wooed by some of the ideas that we talk about in the book. More flexibility, the ability to jump into higher ed and out, right, quickly. When you need new skills, retrain, retool, jump back out. We're going to help you pay for some of that. Those ideas, I think, are very compelling, could be very compelling to that group.
I wanted to jump in on this to make a broader point, which is I think there is a mistake a lot of people think about politics often make, which is to slice the electorate into these demographic groups in a misleading way. So after the 2012 election, there was a lot of talk about how Republicans were doing poorly among three or four groups in particular: Hispanics, single women, young people, and to a lesser degree, white working class, white voters without college degrees. When you do that, people then jump to thinking there's a group-specific reason that needs to be addressed. So with single women, it's the contraceptive mandate. With Hispanics, it's immigration. With young people, it's same-sex marriage. Those play a role. Absolutely, those play a role. But I think the thing that people often underestimate is that each one of those groups is more economically insecure than the national average. Each of those groups is having trouble getting good jobs, having trouble affording health insurance, in many cases, having trouble paying off student loans. Mm-hmm. And each of those groups, when you survey them, they put economics at the top of their list. And so even if you were to solve those group-specific problems, if you don't have a compelling message on the bread and butter concerns, you're going to underperform with each of those groups because they're needier groups.
I mean, it's really interesting to look at, FDR picked up, basically took the African-American vote, which had been much more Republican, and despite the fact that he did nothing on civil rights, right, he picked up a huge proportion of that vote by answering economic needs that they were especially hard hit by the Great Depression. Mm-hmm. And so the feeling that he was doing something about their needs was especially. Yeah.
And I would just the one thing that I would add to that is, especially on the higher ed side, a lot of the policy proposals that Democrats are putting forward are actually fundamentally regressive. Right? They reward the college educated, right? They want states to spend more on public higher education, but that doesn't go to students who need it most, right? It goes to the flagship campuses where the smartest kids and the most affluent kids in the state are going, right? I mean, these ideas, so there's a window here for Republicans to sort of call that out and say, this isn't right. We want to do something different.
Okay, I'm going to ask April one last question, then we'll go to Q&A, which is, how much headway is this making in Washington? Do we actually have a reform conservative presidential candidate is coming sometime,
Well, I mean, I certainly hope so. And that's certainly one of our goals, I think, is to affect that field, which is bigger by the day. There have been a few champions on the Hill that we pay particular attention to.
Can you name names?
Mike Lee in the Senate has just been a phenomenal idea generator. He's got... He's talking about everything from higher ed to taxes to healthcare. So he's just a really phenomenal talent in the Senate, new blood in the Senate. Marco Rubio has been outstanding. Also introduced a lot of legislation, is working on more. They're, in fact, I think, teaming up at the moment on a tax proposal that we're looking forward to. Yeah, Paul Ryan has been doing some good work in the House, so I guess I've named two potential.
And this started with Reagan as governor of California, right? This was his take on Berkeley. I mean, I think he described something, orgies that are beyond description or something, right? It was the way he described what happened on campus at Berkeley. So,
which also served as a recruiting device.
Yes, exactly.
Right, precisely. So that's always been a part of this discussion, and rightfully so. I mean, you know, you're going to look on a college campus, and you're going to see these departments of under-enrolled majors, you know, ethnic studies and women's studies, and so on. And that's going to be something that to a mainstream conservative is going to be not something that they're interested in, or interested in subsidizing, for that matter. That's one of the traditional talking points on it. For me, that's a symptom of a much larger problem, right? And that is a market that doesn't function effectively, so that consumers can say, you know, I don't want to go learn from a professor that's going to fill, you know, my mind with all sorts of nonsense and things that are going to, you know, make my parents blush, right? But instead, your only choice these days, frankly, as an up-and-coming high school graduate, is to go off to a four-year college and enroll in a place, if you want to get ahead, and enroll in a place that is populated, happens to be populated with that type of faculty. But again, that's a function of a market that rewards that kind of behavior and that sort of product, because you know there's not a broader array of options open to people, and so I think we get bogged down in the politics, the sort of hand-to-hand combat, right, over liberalism on campuses, and we lose sight of the fact that that's a symptom of this broader problem.
So Yuval, is that preventing Republicans though from having the kind of resources that, yes, as policy advisors, the Democrats can draw deep into the economy, and Republicans have a small handful of, yeah, of Republicans, conservatives at any given university?
I think the question of anti-intellectualism and the right is a very complicated and important question. It's not as simple as a lot of people make it out to be. In a certain sense, conservatives are much more intellectual in their thinking about politics than liberals. Liberals want to be understood as pragmatists. Conservatives want to think of themselves as having some kind of philosophy. At the same time, there's this attitude about the academy, and there's the actual academy, which justifies a lot of that attitude.
Yes, in fairness, I don't think Reagan was wrong to say that the faculty at Berkeley was lefty.
Not always here at Chicago, but sometimes, and in a lot of other places. I do think that has meant that, as you say, conservatives have not been able to draw on the academy in the same way. So I run a quarterly journal of essays about public policy. And a lot of the people who write for us are people who ought to be academics but aren't. Mm-hmm. They're people who are at think tanks when they'd rather be teaching. They're people who are on Wall Street when they'd rather be academics and intellectuals. And the reason is they think they can't be academics because they're conservatives. In some cases, they're right. I think that in a lot of cases, they're not right. But that's an attitude that's very prevalent on the right. And it's why conservatives tend to rely more on think tanks and liberals more on universities. I think there's a huge advantage in that for the left, because universities just seem to offer more credibility than a think tank that's kind of understood to be a political actor. But it is a reality. I would also say my own attitude about the academy is different from a lot of conservatives. I think there's an enormous amount of very valuable work being done in the social sciences. There's not in today's academy, in the way there used to be, is the just amazing generalist, the extraordinary learned intellectual that even through the 1960s and into the 70s we saw in the American Academy, and that played a big part actually in the development of conservatism in America. That person is really hard to find now. That person would have a very hard time getting and keeping an academic job. And that's a fault of the university, and has not been any better for the university than it's been for conservatives. But there are a lot of great specialists, and I don't think it's right to see the academy as a kind of sea of useless inanity. There's a lot of good work being done, and there's a lot of useless inanity, and that's just the nature of the thing.
Thankfully, unlike journalism, where it's
100%.
So I'm going to throw out a list of some issues that are kind of like the big issues that people are talking about right now: healthcare, immigration, inequality, family formation, climate change. Which of those does this address effectively, and which of them doesn't? You know, do we not yet have a...
Yeah, well, I mean, one dimension of reform conservatism is an attempt to supply effective, politically effective answers for conservatism about the issues that most Americans care about. And in part, that involves reorienting the conversation to the issues most Americans care about. And that was an interesting list that you put out there. I mean, if you think about the conversation in Washington, D.C. over the last 2 years, how much of it has been about immigration or inequality or climate change, issues that on a good day will get a combined 6% of the American public saying that's the top issue that that Congress ought to be thinking of. And the issues that Americans really want to focus on are these bread and butter concerns about the cost of living, about wage stagnation. Healthcare is definitely one of them. But they don't, you know, they don't think about these issues in the ideological terms that the left and the right do. They like smaller government. It's not their top priority, getting smaller government. They don't like inequality. It's not at all a high priority for them. What they really want is a rising standard of living for people in the middle of the income spectrum. And that's what I think we're talking about. Now, I think, you know, I have my own views about each and every one of the issues that you discussed.
You're kidding.
But I think that it's very easy to for political activists and actors to get caught up in the issues that animate us and lose sight of the issues that are of foremost concern of the people.
Well, April, let me ask, why does that happen? Why do we end up focused on these things? As I agree that, you know, the pocketbook is...
Partly it's, you know, the folks that scream the loudest in Washington get the most attention, right? And so, you know, you've got big parts of your base that are concerned about certain issues that the general public just isn't that worried about. You know, I think this is the case with, you know, the inequality issue in particular. I mean, I think that's something that I want to say it's somewhere around 3% is of the public says that that's a top issue for them. But that is, you've certainly seen more than 3% of the news coverage, I think, on that issue. And, you know, that's it's the kind of thing that, you know, we inside the Beltway types just tend to respond to each other a whole lot.
Well, in fairness, if you're a journalist making a modest sum and living in New York or D.C. with lobbyists and hedge fund managers,
right.
It's a very pressing issue. Have you ever tried to get your child into a really good preschool? Well, like...
Henry's, high income, high earners, not rich yet.
You're not rich yet.
Yet.
So, Andrew, actually, income mobility, is that a big issue for people, do you think? I mean, is it distinct from income inequality?
I think one of the more interesting things that we've seen over the past year, year and a half, is actually a pivot on the part of Democrats as well, away from some of this rhetoric around inequality and toward rhetoric around opportunity. I think that's a much more appealing frame to most people, and I think you can't have a conversation about that today without talking about education, and particularly what happens after you graduate from high school.
Realistically, though, how much can we? I mean, I feel like we've been pounding at get more kids through college. We're getting like fewer kids through high school. We've been pounding away at this sort of we need more trained workers. Like this is the evergreen from every political campaign forever and ever and ever. What do we do now that's different than what we have? What's the insanity of trying to do the same thing over and over again and get different results?
Sure, and I think. The interesting thing is that both parties have been guilty of this problem, right? So we had, you know, Democrats' natural inclination is to try and solve the problems with schools and colleges from Washington, right? They can't do that. They can pass laws that ask the bureaucracy to write rules that are supposed to impact the way states and local districts and colleges do their work. George W. Bush fell into the same trap with No Child Left Behind. And this was a very prescriptive attempt to fix schools from D.C. I think that what my colleague Rick Hess and I try to lay out in Room to Grow is a different way of thinking about the federal role, and it is the antithesis of centralizing power over decision making in Washington, and it is to devolve it out to actors who are closer to the problem on the ground. Who can actually solve problems, and as Yuval says in his wonderful chapter, allow people to through trial and error figure out better ways to solve the problems that they face in their local area, their school district, and their particular school. Have Washington kind of retreat from that, but bear in mind the need to create space for problem solvers to do their work.
So Yuval, I want to ask, because you've said some great stuff about this, about leaving more space between the federal government for all sorts of, for local government, for institutions that aren't the government, and viewing, instead of, in the modern political discourse, we tend to view this, either there's the big federal government, maybe a little bit little state government, and then like everything else is this individual sphere, and there's almost nothing in between. And Republicans have long talked a great game about decentralization, devolution, all the rest of it. And yet you look at like what Bush's signature achievements, the Iraq War and No Child Left Behind, which are both these, why, I mean, first of all, why don't Republicans put their money where their mouth is, and how do you change that?
Yeah, I think part of it is thinking beyond this question of devolution exactly. I mean, to me, this also gets to your prior question about the subjects we take up. I think in some ways, the place where we can be most useful is not in deciding what subjects ought to be taken up, because that's not up to us anyway, but in thinking about how to approach public problems. And I think there's a great difference between the left and the right in America on the question of how to approach public problems, where there's an inclination on the left, as you say, and it's rooted in progressive thinking that's very interesting and serious, although I think a lot of contemporary progressives don't really wrestle with that thinking very much. That suggests that we ought to think about American society as consisting of individuals and a state, and that the role of the state is to enable those individuals to live the lives they want to lead. This is not a crazy idea, and it's a very appealing idea, but conservatives emphasize what happens in the space between those two, between the individual and the state, where our families are, where our civic institutions.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Steve Edwards, the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's event entitled The New Conservative Agenda. It's a fitting conversation not only because of the change in power in the United States Senate and the Republican leadership in both houses of Congress that we'll expect after the first of the year, but also as candidates are vying for the Republican nomination in 2016, and I think perhaps more centrally, vying to define where the party and what conservatism means and where it goes in the years ahead. Tonight's conversation, as many of you know, is part of our ongoing speaker series, which aims to provide leading experts on key issues of the day in a forum that hopefully elevates and expands the public conversation. Tomorrow night, we will be back here on campus with a conversation that focuses on national security in the 21st century, featuring an outstanding panel that includes former U.S. Ambassador to NATO, Ivo Dalder, former Congresswoman Jane Harman, and as well, current Washington Post reporter David Ignatius. Promises to be a great conversation. You can find out more about all of our events at politics.uchicago.edu. You can also subscribe to a podcast of all of our events by going to iTunes U and searching for UChicago IOP. Tonight during our conversation, as is customary, we will turn the microphone over to you, the members of our audience, a bit later so that you can pose your questions to our panelists. When we do, we ask that you keep your conversation, or your question rather, short and to the point so that we can get to as many of you as possible. We will also prioritize students in the overall mix of questioners tonight. It's now my great pleasure to turn things over to Max Samuels to introduce our distinguished panel for tonight's conversation. Max is a third year here at the University of Chicago. He is a former president of the College Republicans on campus. He currently leads the UChicago Political Union and is the UChicago chair of the American Enterprise Institute on campus chapter. Please join me in welcoming Max Samuels. Max?
Thank you, Steve. I can't do it without paper. Sorry, guys. It's my honor to introduce today's panel. Republicans won a sweeping electoral victory last November, yet many Americans struggle to identify with an affirmative party message. The IOP has assembled today's most sought-after conservative policy wonks to tell us how they think that the Republican Party can close this gap. These thought leaders collaborated to write Room to Grow, a manifesto for a reformicon agenda that makes conservatism work for the middle class. When commentators refer to the intellectual resurgence of the Republican Party, they are referring to our guest today, and I have no doubt you will soon see why. Our first panelist is Andrew Kelly, the director of the Center on Higher Education Reform at the American Enterprise Institute. He researches higher education policy, including financial aid reform. Dr. Kelly is a prolific author whose work has appeared in publications ranging from the American Journal of Education to The Atlantic. Yuval Levin is the Hertog Fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center and holds a variety of senior editorial positions, chief among them as editor of National Affairs. He served on the domestic policy staff of the Bush White House and earned his PhD at the University of Chicago. He recently published The Great Debate, Edmund Burke, Thomas Paine, and the Birth of Right and Left. April Ponnuru is a veteran Capitol Hill staffer and the policy director for the YG Network, which published the Room to Grow essays. She has served in both Senate and House leadership, including as senior advisor to Senator Roy Blunt of Missouri. Previously, she served as executive director of the nonprofit National Review Institute. Her husband, Ramesh Ponnuru, is a senior editor for National Review, a columnist for Bloomberg View, and a visiting fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. Ramesh is one of the most prolific and respected commentators in Washington, and his work can be found in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and many, many other places. Ramesh served as an IOP fellow in 2013, and we are thrilled to have him back. Last but certainly not least, our moderator this evening will be Megan McArdle, a Bloomberg View columnist who writes on economics, business, and public policy. Ms. McArdle is also behind the popular blog Asymmetric Information, and a UChicago Business School alum. She is currently completing her term as an IOP Fall Fellow. As you see, we have a ton of talent here today, so please join me in welcoming the participants.
So I'm going to start off by asking you a question, Ramesh. 2014 was a great year for Republicans, right? We had, and maybe not a tsunami, but certainly like a decent sizable wave. I say we as a nation, not personally as a Republican. Why does conservatism need to be reformed? Why not just keep on keeping on?
Well, first of all, it's okay to say you're Republican if you are. You're my friends. You know, I think that one thing that Republicans should have learned from recent years is that the midterm electorate looks very different from the presidential electorate. And you can be very good at winning midterm elections without having what it takes to win presidential elections. I think that's for a couple reasons. One is because it's easier to get people to let you apply the brake pedal than it is to get them to give you control over the steering wheel. In presidential elections, I think the public thinks of as much more steering wheel elections. And they need to know that Republicans want to take them somewhere they want to go before they'll do that.
Hence all the Obama metaphors about driving the
car getting
into
the ditch. That's right, yeah. And then the other thing is that, you know, there's always been a demographic distinction between who turns out in midterms and who turns out in presidential elections. For example, you have the midterm electorate is older and whiter, for example. In recent years, that demographic distinction has taken on a much more partisan cast than it used to. So we now, I think, have a structural feature of our politics where Republicans tend to outperform in midterms and Democrats in presidential elections. So you don't need to reform anything if you're a Republican who is fine with having a congressional majority. It's easy to keep the House majority, relatively speaking. It's a little harder, but still quite doable to take a Senate majority. You've got to reach a little further if you want to form a governing center-right majority in this country, which is what I would be interested in.
So, April, I'm going to go to you, since you are the YG Network fearless leader. What is reform conservatism? I mean, is it a bunch of different ideas? Is it merely a sense that we need to reform conservatism and okay, let's do it?
Right.
Or is there some sort of coherent core here that's a kind of philosophy?
Right. I mean, I think we're very comfortable in the conservative tradition. I don't think we're, in that sense, offering anything new. That the principles that conservatism has espoused for a long time, certainly over the last few decades, are principles that we're comfortable with and feel need to be expanded upon. I think what reform conservatism is the effort to apply those principles to the problems that we face today. So, where conservatives or Republicans have often had an agenda that focuses on bringing down the marginal tax rate, right? Which was, you know, pre-Reagan confiscatory. I mean, we were talking about a 70% rate. And there was a real urgent need at the time to bring that rate down. You know, Reagan saw that need, and he prioritized. He applied the conservative principles that we believe in to that situation, and said, "Look, we need to bring this rate down, you know, dramatically." And he did, and he was effective, partly because we were successful. A lot of our agenda has become rather outdated. We haven't been responding to the challenges of our day. And so reform conservatism is really trying to bring to bear the principles that we believe in to the particular policy challenges that we face as a nation today.
So Yuval, could you talk a little bit about what are the core policy challenges that Republicans mm-hmm. aren't addressing now or aren't addressing effectively now yeah. and need to be?
Well, let me say, I agree entirely with what April says, and I think it's important that I'm not entirely sure where the term reform conservatism came from, though I don't dislike the term. I think of it as a reforming conservatism. In other words, our target is not conservatism. Our target is the government and the nation's challenges, and what's required to address those is a reform of our governing institutions and of a lot of public policy. And so it is applied conservatism, and what that means in practice, it seems to me, is a modernization of conservatism's understanding of the challenges the country faces. I don't think it's a change in how we as conservatives need to think about solving public problems. I think it's a change in what we understand those problems to be. And so if, as you say, in 1981, where a lot of conservatives like to live, the problems had to do with hyperinflation and with high marginal income tax rates, today, the challenges have more to do with the consequences of globalization for working Americans. They have more to do with stagnating wages. They have more to do with the pressures that middle-class families confront. To the extent that we want to talk about tax reform, I think that the tax burden is especially heavy as a result of the payroll tax and not the income tax for most Americans. And it means thinking about how conservative ideas need to be applied to contemporary challenges. The most difficult thing for both parties now, I think, is to see the present, is to look beyond the to-do list that they've both had for such a long time, and to actually think about what the country's to-do list ought to be. A lot of Democrats like to live in the mid-60s, a lot of Republicans like to live in the early 80s, because those are times when it seemed like they had something real to offer, and the country saw it too. The country doesn't live there in either of those times, and you just can't pretend that they do. I think the fact that both parties are trying so hard to pretend is why so many Americans are frustrated with politics.
Yeah, I look at the list of things that Reagan got done, and some of them, you know, he lowered taxes. On the other hand, on regulation, not so much. And
yeah.
So I actually want to go to the end of our back there. Hi.
Hi.
And talk a little bit about Republican anti-intellectualism. This is a charge that gets labeled a lot, is that they're sort of, rather than having an education policy, rather than, they're just sort of reflexively anti the academy, and all of that represents, including coming up with policy. I mean, can you talk a little, is that true? Is it fair? Or?
I think it is. I mean, you know, when I think about the sort of traditional, the well-worn talking points on higher ed, right? One of them is lefty faculty and permissive norms on campus, right? This